Good morning, viewers. A warm welcome to the CEB Suryapet Khammam Bioscience online class. This is Kausar Anjum, working as TGT Science in TS Model School, Imampet Village, Suryapet Mandalan District. Children, today I am going to discuss you the topic sexual reproduction in plants. So here, what are the learning outcomes? We will see now. When I finish my class, you can know that flower is a sexual part of a plant. You can explain various parts of a flower and you can give reason why stamen and carpel are called as sexual parts of a flower. You can cite examples for unisexual flowers and bisexual flowers. You can analyze the importance of various parts of a flower. You can interpret the term pollination. Finally, you can differentiate self-pollination and cross-pollination. So let's enter into our main topic with introduction. There are so many plants, so many lakhs of species of plants are there, lakhs of species of flowers are there. So till now, 2,75,000 species are known. So almost all of them give rise to flowers and the fruits which encloses the seeds. So the flowering plants can range from so tall, so many meters tall, to very, very tiny plants. So in all these, what is the role played by flower, how it undergoes reproduction, we will see now. So overall, we will see the importance of flower, the parts of flower and their functions. So here the examples for the tall trees I'm taking are salt tree and a giant cactus. So before entering into the flower topic flower, I want to tell you why the flower is the sexual part and what the remaining parts of the plant are called. Children, you can see here there is a plant. Generally, a plant has so many structures that the stem, leaves, roots, branches, and flowers. So in this, all the plants have their own functions, isn't it? Since your early classes, you are learning what is the importance of root, what are the functions of stem, leaves, and all, isn't it? So here this figure, except the flower, the remaining all the parts are called as vegetative parts, and the flower is called as a sexual part. So here a big question arises, why the flower is called as sexual part? In the sense, flower has sexual male and female parts. So as the flower has a male sexual part and the female sexual part, the flower is termed as a sexual part of the plant. Whereas coming to the various other parts like stem, leaves, roots, there are no male and female differences, and those are not the sexual parts. So those are named as the vegetative parts. So flower is a sexual part as it has differentiation of a male sexual part and a female sexual part. Now we will enter into the main topic, that is a flower, the sexual part of a plant. So see here, children, here a nice and beautiful flower is displayed on the screen, and you can see various parts here. So actually a flower contains its parts in whorls. Whorls in the sense circles, okay. So each flower has four circles, the outermost, next, and the innermost. Like that, the four whorls are present, and each whorl has its own importance and have a different name. So here, there are four important parts in a flower which are arranged in whorls. They are calyx, corolla, stamen, and carpel. Okay. How many parts, children? Four. The outermost whorl is calyx. The third whorl is corolla. And the second whorl, stamen. and the innermost whorl is carpel. So here, these green color structures are the sepals. In later slides, I'll show you what are sepals and explain you better. See here, and next, these colorful parts are the petals for which we attract and we like to put that flower in our brain, isn't it? And these parts are the stamens, and this part is called as carpel. In further slides, I'll explain you each and every part, children. I hope you have understood. A plant has various parts, majorly categorized into two. One is a vegetative part, and the second is a sexual part. The sexual part of the plant is a flower, as it has male and female reproductive organs. And a flower, coming to the flower, a flower has its parts in whorls. There are four whorls in the flower. Okay, the calyx, corolla, stamen, and carpel. So we will move now. It is the sepals. You can see here these green color structures. These are called as sepals. Then what is calyx? What is the difference between the sepals and calyx? Sepal means it can be a one or individually. Individually, through a single we can tell as sepal. But all together, combinedly, it is called as calyx. Okay. And sepals are the outermost whorl of the flower. So see here, if you see a flower, the outermost part is the are the sepals. So these are the outermost whorl. Are these sepals situated in circle or not? Yes. So it is called as whorl. And which color these are means it, these are green in color. So sepals are the outermost part of the flower, and these are green in color. Collectively, the sepals are called as calyx. So what is the function, we will know later. Okay, so now we will move to the next part, that is the petals. Okay, so those are the petals. All the petals together called as corolla. So see here, children, these the bright pink color structures are called as petals. And what these green color, children? These are the sepals. So the first whorl is a sepal, the next whorl is a petal. So petals are the second whorl of the flower. So from, if we see from the outside, it is the second whorl. And these are the most beautiful part of a flower. We, birds, insects, all will attract to the flower by seeing its beauty and the fragrance it emits, isn't it? So these are the most beautiful and the delicate parts of the flower. These are very delicate, very sensitive, isn't it? So petals are the second whorl of the flower. These are colorful. These are, you know, are of various colors. And these emits the fragrance. Okay. So what is its function? We will see later. And next, the third whorl are the stamen. Stamen combinedly together called as andricium. So see here, children. These 1, 2, 3, 4. These four structures which are displayed are the stamens. Okay. And these are called as male reproductive parts. Why these are called as male reproductive parts? Because these produce the male sex cells. Okay, so male reproductive parts produces the male sex cells. So if you see the individual stamen, it contains two parts. A stamen contains two parts. This upper part is called as anther, and the stalk of the anther is called as filament. So a stamen has how many parts, children? Two parts. The upper part is called as anther, and this lower part is called as filament. And in this anther, the male sex cells are produced, which are called as pollen grains. Okay. So in next class, you will come to know how to observe the pollen grain and the sex cells which are present inside. So stamen is the third whorl of the flower. It is a male reproductive part of the flower because it produces male sex cells, and all the stamens together called as andricium. Each stamen has two parts. The upper part is called as anther, and the stalk of the anther is called as filament. And inside the anther, there will be the pollen grains. Okay, I hope you have understood what is a stamen. Next, the innermost whorl, the central part of the flower, is the carpel. Carpel can also be called as pistil. It can also be called as gynecium. Okay, carpel can also be called as pistil. Pistil can also be called as gynecium. It is the innermost whorl of the flower and it is the female part of a flower. Again, a question arises, why it is called as female part, children? Because it produces the female sex cell, which is called as egg. Okay, so see here, children, in a flower, this single part, it is called as the female part, which is called as carpel. Again, this carpel, if you see, it has three parts. This upper part is called as stigma, and this stalk-like structure, this tube-like structure called as style, and this lower bulged part is called as ovary. Inside the ovary, there will be the ovule, and inside the ovule, there will be the female sex cell, which is called as egg. Okay, so carpel is the innermost whorl of the flower. It can also be called as pistil or gynecium. And it is the female part of the flower because it produces the female sex cell, which is called as egg. Okay. And pistil has three parts. The uppermost part is called as the stigma. Next, the tube-like structure called as style. And the lower bulged part is called as ovary. Inside the ovary, ovule is present. And inside the ovule, egg is present. So till now we have discussed the complete structure of a flower. A flower has four whorls. The outermost whorl are the sepals. The second whorl, petals. The third whorl, andrecium. And the innermost whorl is the gynecium. I hope you have understood what are the parts of the flower and what are their names. Okay, next we'll move further. Now a question is displayed here. What function do you think is served by sepals and petals? What function is served by sepals and petals, children? Sepals are outermost whorl. Those, the function is to protect the ovary. Inside the ovary, female sex cell is there, which is the most important. So, to protect that egg, the outermost sepals are present. Next, coming to the petals. What is the petals, children? The importance of petal is its beauty. So by seeing the beauty, we attract. Not only we, each and every living organism attracts. So the petals are the beautiful structures which attract the insects, birds for pollination. So what is pollination? You are familiar. But once again, we will I will explain you in further slides. So now we will move ahead. Now see here, the topic changes that how many types of flowers are there depending upon the parts present in it. So flower is of two types. One is unisexual and the second is bisexual. Okay, flowers are of two types. One is unisexual flower and the second the bisexual flower. Uni in the sense one, bi means two, sexual means sexual parts. If a flower has only one sexual part, either male or female, then it is called as unisexual. Bisexual flower, if the flower has both the sexual parts, like andrecium and gynecium, both are present in that, then it is called as bisexual flower. So here, the examples are for unisexual flower, cucumber and papaya. Okay, bottle gourd is also the example for the unisexual flower. These flowers have either andrecium or gynecium, but not both in one. And coming to the bisexual flower, Datura, lily and hibiscus. These are the best examples, children. And we can give the typical example for the bisexual flower is a Datura. Why we take this as a best example in the sense, in the this flower has all the parts clearly visible. We can demonstrate all the parts easily in this flower. So most of the teachers will consider this as the best flower for the explanation of the parts of the flower. I hope you have understood. Flowers are of two types, unisexual and bisexual, depending upon the parts which are present in that. Next, we'll move further. Now it is the next topic, that is the pollination. have learned what is pollination in your 7th standard, and even you have learned about the unisexual and bisexual flowers also. So here pollination means transfer of pollen grains from anther to stigma of the flower is called as pollination. So anther has the pollen grains and stigma is the female part. Anther is a male part. From the male part, if the pollen grains are transferred to the upper part of the female part, which is called as stigma, then it is called as pollination. So pollination is of two types. One is self-pollination and the second is the cross-pollination. Self means within, cross means from one to the another. So for the self-pollination, the example I have taken is a datura, and for the cross-pollination, the example I have taken is a papaya. You can give other examples also. Now, we will go for the types of pollination with the figure. I'll explain you with the diagram. See here, children, this is the self-pollination. This central part is a female part. This is a stigma, this is a style, and the ovary. Inside the ovary, ovule and egg are present. And these parts are the stamens. This is the pollen, this is the anther, and this is the filament. From the anther, the pollen grains will be transferred to the stigma. This is called as pollination. If the pollen grains from the same flower are transferred to the stigma of the same flower, then it is called as self-pollination. And the cross pollination, here I have taken two flowers, and from the pollen grains from the anther of one flower are transferred to the stigma of another flower, then this type is called as cross pollination. Self pollination and cross pollination. So here a question arises: how these pollen grains are traveling, who are taking them? So we will move further. I'll explain you in this slide. So these are the pollinating agents. Agent means what? One who takes. Agent means one who takes. So what these agents are taking means pollen grains. So those are called as pollinating agents. So the agents which help in the transfer of pollen grains from anther to stigma of a flower are called as pollinating agents. Okay. So pollinating agents are of number of types. So those can be insects, those can be birds, so those can be other animals, and also the wind, water. Okay, so all these are considered as the pollinating agents. Next, see here children, there is one question displayed here. Are there any observable characters that help you to find out whether a plant is self-pollinating or cross-pollinating? Plant in the sense flower, children. How can we say that if by observing a flower, can we tell that is it self-pollinating or cross-pollinating? Can we tell? Yes, we can. If the flower is unisexual, only one sexual part is there, can it undergo the self-pollination? No, it cannot undergo. Oh, definitely, it has to seek for the another flower for the pollination, isn't it? So the unisexual flowers will have only the option that it should go for the cross-pollination. Whereas the bisexual flowers can undergo the self-pollination as well as the cross-pollination. By seeing a bisexual flower, can we say that definitely it should undergo the cross-pollination? Is there any chance? Let's see. Now see, children, this is the bisexual flower. This central part is the female part, and these are the male parts, isn't it? So here, there is a less chance that the pollen grains can fall on this stigma, isn't it? So here, there is a chance that if this flower can prefer to go for the cross-pollination. If the pollen grains are, if this anthers, if the stamens are taller, then what happens? Almost it will go for the self-pollination, because these stamens, when they are taller than the female part, the pollen grains will fall on the stigma easily, isn't it? So there is a scope for the self-pollination. But in these type of bisexual flowers, chances are there. Most of the chances are there for the cross pollination, and self pollination can also occur because of wind. Okay, I hope you have understood. This figure is very suitable for the explanation of the flower parts. Once again, I'll recapitulate you the parts. This is the outermost part, outermost whorl sepals. Next, this is the second whorl, that is the petals. This is the third whorl stamen, combined called as antrisium. And this is the innermost whorl, which is called as a carpel or pistil or gynecium. I hope you have understood all the concepts very well. Why the flower is called as reproductive part, what are the parts in the flower and their importance, how many types of flowers are there, unisexual, bisexual, what is pollination, how many types of pollinations are there, and what are pollinating agents. Okay, so now we will move to the last part of today's session, that is evaluation. Now here the first question is, name the vegetative and reproductive parts in a plant. Vegetative parts are stem, roots, leaves, okay, and you can see even branches also. And coming to the reproductive part, it is a flower. And why flower is called as a reproductive part? Because it has male and female organs. So it is called as a reproductive part. Write the differences in between the following. The first is unisexual and bisexual flower. What are the differences, children? Unisexual flower has either male part, male sexual part, or female sexual part, but not both. So the example for the unisexual flower is the papaya or cucumber. And coming to the bisexual flower, children, this flower has both male and female parts, both male and female sexual parts. And the best example is datura, or you can give the lily or hibiscus. And next, coming to the self-pollination and cross-pollination. Self-pollination means a transfer of pollen grains from anther to stigma of the same flower. Then it is called as self-pollination. And coming to the cross-pollination, transfer of pollen grains from anther of one flower to the stigma of another flower. Then it is called as cross-pollination. Next, next question, children. What is pollination? How cross-pollination is brought out? Pollination means transfer of pollen grains from anther of the flower to the stigma of the flower, of the same flower or the another flower, is called as pollination. And how cross-pollination is brought out means cross-pollination is brought out with the help of pollinating agents such as wind or water or birds, insects, etc. Next, draw the structure of a flower and explain its parts. You have to draw the structure of the flower and you have to explain its part, that a flower has its parts in the whorls. The outermost whorl is a sepal. Next whorl is the petals. Third whorl stamens, and the innermost whorl is the pistil or carpel or gynecium. And you have to explain about those parts and the importance. Okay, I hope you have understood today's session. Try to answer all these questions on your own and get it corrected from your teachers. Okay, thank you for watching my class.